Good evening. It's a great pleasure to welcome Jun Aoki to the AA. I think without a doubt, Jun Aoki is among the most important and interesting architects currently practicing in Japan. It's clearly quite a change from the lecture last week by John Caminada that we had from Switzerland, because those of you who were here know that Caminada is working in a very small village in Berin with a population of 280 people, and he did about 20 buildings in this small village. And Jun Aoki is working under very, very different circumstances, a lot of projects in Tokyo, working for commercial companies, in particular the Louis Vuitton brand, where the circumstances of permanence that are so significant in small villages of Switzerland are replaced by a very fast-moving circumstance where the architecture has to really respond to the specific conditions of the brand, of locality, of sales, and the very specific situations of the marketplace. Probably over the last 10 or so years, Jun Aoki has systematically developed a series of projects, starting with relatively modest, small-scale projects, shops and so on, and developed a variety of techniques, architectural proposals that are, despite or maybe partly because of the very conditions of the brand, are deeply based in the area of research, material investigation, and so on and so forth, to the point where many of these explorations were realized, I think, very beautifully in the more sort of recent project at LV Omotesando, which was open now probably about a year and a bit ago. 1 year, it was September of last year. I was fortunate to work with Jun Aoki on an exhibition of his work, and in fact, other architects who did projects for LV, which was a real pleasure, in Tokyo. And the result of that work has also been documented in a book that was published called Logique Visuelle by LV, which is also available from Triangle Bookshop, where you can see many of Jun Aoki's projects. Of course, his projects have also been published in many international journals over the last few years, and next year there is a monograph of his work that will be available. In addition to working with commercial companies, Jun Aoki has also been involved in a number of museum projects and other art installations, among them the Aomori Museum of Fine Art and the Fukushima Lagoon Museum, which we actually published, I think, in AA Files number 46 or so, if I'm not mistaken. So without any further delay, as I said, it's a great pleasure to have Aoki-san here. Please welcome Jun Aoki.
Thank you very much for your comments. And thank you for giving me the opportunity to talk here. It's my greatest pleasure. And my lecture is entitled The Circulation Body today. And the circulation body is, of course, a coined word I made. And the reason why I choose this word is that I feel almost all my work can be described in terms of this word. But could you start the projector? Thank you. This is a very interesting island in Japan, and also I must very surprised because I visited today and I found in this AA the exhibition about this island will be held in the very near future. Its name is Gunkanjima. It's a battleship island. And it earned its nickname because it cannot be looked at as a natural island, but an artificial battleship. It is a very tiny island indeed, but it was a good place to operate coal mining. And the space was limited. And in the 1960s, the peak population of 5,300 was marked. And it means the population density was about 10 times that of Tokyo at the time. And the mining operation closed in 1974. And I have been there in 1993. And it was already a ruined island. And this isn't an underground building. And this isn't ours. And this is a roof garden. Oh, and this is a section of island, and this is island, very tiny, but still the coal mine is the underground. It is very, very interesting situation. And you cannot tell where is the ground level in this island, or the which floor you are now in this island. The density is too high to tell them. And I found a primary school on the perhaps seventh floor. And imagine the children's life at that time. And the boy might live in the room of a fifth floor of this building. And if so, he might not go down to the ground in order to go to school. And he might just go up to the seventh floor and walk along the corridor and cross several buildings and leave the school. He might spend a day without going down once to the house. The corridors were also roads here, and there wasn't any distinction between roads and the buildings. The visit, this visit shocked me very much. And at the time, this is about 10 years ago when I started my own design. And I was designing a small bridge in a town, in a small town on the southern Japanese island of Kyushu. And it is the existing bridge, and I rebuilt it. Existed though it seemed to refer to a beautiful old arch bridge nearby, but I felt the existed new bridge is very far from this aesthetics. Anyway, this town is once prosperous. The picture shows how it looked like about 100 years ago, and it was much more prosperous than nowadays. The town was an overnight stop on the old post town. Actually, there remains several old inns in this town, which reminds us the townscape of the Golden Age. In the post town, about 200 years ago in Japan, there were so many prosperous towns as post stops. The Hiroshige Ando, left a famous ukiyo-e picture set of Tokaido, 53 post towns. Tokaido is the, even now, the route connecting Tokyo and Kyoto. And this is the picture on Tokyo. And the bridge is the centerpiece of the picture. And this is Kyoto. Also, the bridge is the centerpiece of the picture. And Kanaya. And if I include this kind of ferry into bridges, the number of the picture which describe a bridge came up to 20. It means approximately 50% of the pictures. Among those pictures, this is my favorite one, Takegawa. The bridge isn't portrayed as an object. It is true just as a special part of a road, where at least three categories of people are meeting. One from this side, a family of travelers, and the other a group of monks, and the last group of farmers. And then we can find the five post towns symbolized so often by bridges. The reason is very simple. And a bridge was the kind of hub and where many routes once meet. And the post towns were developed from these dense area of networks. Extremely saying the post towns were developed from roads. And this is the famous bridge of Avignon, and the famous children's song, Lonidas, Lonidas, through Pont d'Avignon. But if you visit there, you will be disappointed, because it doesn't have a special look. It's the, in this case too, the bridge isn't an object to be viewed, but the place to be danced. Through these observations, I decided not to design the bridge as an independent object and not to insert it into the network of the laws. Instead, I decided to find a way to evolve and mutate a part of road. The road at the edge of the river, they split vertically into to upper section and the lower section. Then they fuse again together once more at the ASEAN end. And this is how this part of the road is mutated. The lower section of reversing the shape of a traditional Japanese arched bridge. The enclosed space created by the upper and lower sections is providing a shaded space. You can feel river cool breeze and look down cool running waters through the circular holes perforated into on the floor. But from the side, it looks like a pair of lips. In the evening, the neighborhood is gathering at the bridge to open a party. And I was complained by one of them that it is very inconvenient because this bridge doesn't have any electrical connectors. They wanted to use a karaoke set here. And I think I am the first bridge designer for his complaint because of the lack of the electric connectors. A bridge can be described as part of roads. And if space in general can be divided into space to be linked and the linking space, a bridge is not a space to be linked, but a linking space from its origin. And so we can create a bridge very easily by evolving or mutating a linking space. In a city, roads are linking space, and the buildings are spaces to be linked. And in the building, the corridors are linking spaces, and the rooms are spaces to be linked. And we live in a world which basically gives precedence to space to be linked. For example, why were the roads created? And as they say, cities have many places people have to build. The space to be linked, like markets, the theater, the temples, and so on. And as they say, roads were built in order to link these places. But in the design of this bridge, I tried to give precedence to linking space and to evolve the bridge from laws. And then I was fascinated to develop the idea in architecture. It means that I wanted to try and design architecture by mutating linking spaces, such as corridors, foyer, stairs, and elevators. And this is a project for the architecture. And this is a lagoon area. And a town is pushing towards the lagoon. And the city government decided to create a buffer zone between them to preserve the environment of lagoon. And the idea was to create a lagoon museum just by extending the pedestrian deck. This is a road between the lagoon and the park site. And the cars have to left on this side of the road to protect the ecosystem of the lagoon. The people have to cross the road to reach the lagoon, and the pedestrian deck over the road was required. So the idea was to mutate this pedestrian deck to an architecture. The basic circulation is the tubular spiral stairs, which is from the ground floor to top, and it is encircled by another gently sloping but broad spiral slope. So it means a double spiral. And these circulating spaces from the main part of the architecture. If divided in elements, the almost all elements are for circulations. It looks like a reverse version of a Guggenheim Museum in New York. Instead of the surrounding circular exhibit hall wall, here you can view the real nature of the lagoon through the transparent glass. A lower part of the building is covered by wood because this area was supposed to be hidden in the future by trees. But at the time to shoot the photograph, the trees was not dense yet. A part of a wooden element is projecting towards the lagoon and functions as entrance canopy. This is our entrance hall. The third floor here, which is the pedestrian deck level, works as a high side light for the entrance hall. This is from third floor, and you can see the tubular spiral staircase ascending and penetrating the space. This is spiral formed observation gallery, which gives a panoramic view of the lagoon. Then you can walk up and enjoy the scenery big changes according to the height you are. The floor is finished with black asphalt-like material. I intended to give you usual feeling of a load. The floors in this building are almost inclined, but here is just very special. Only here, the floor is flat. This is the observation gallery, observation hall at the top. With a scenic lagoon as a backdrop, this building is predominantly organized by those linking spaces. And I call this kind of architecture as circulation body. The circulation body doesn't have spaces to be linked. And it has only linking spaces, unusual the space to be linked or donated to some functions. But in this circulation body, the functions evolve from merely linking spaces. Next project. And after the design of this Nagoya Museum, I was asked to design a building for Snow Foundation. The Snow Foundation is a foundation which makes researches into ways of using snow and spread these ways. My idea was the building should make use of snow too. This region experiences snows measuring as much as 3 meters in winter. And this is the special snow removal vehicle, which gathers snow by this spiral, very, very dangerous. Throw snow away from here. This is still the existing building next to this our building, and this is the plan of our snow foundation, like a snowball. Not the big mouse. This is a video clip for explaining the system of the snow bed air conditioning system. And the snow, the way snow is used is now as a source of heat in air conditioning. And the necessary amount of snow is stored during the winter and used in the summer. And many holes in the snow. And the air is decooled inside of this snow storage. And now it's cool, and it's been cool. And this ceiling is the cooled, and the works as a cooling surface. Anyway, the balance between the volume of rooms to be cooled and the volume of snow is well calculated, and this constellation determines the basic volume of the rooms in the snow storage. And the snow is through and by the snow removable vehicle, so the storage has to be accessible from ground level. The snow storage is therefore the only half level. The snow storage is on the half basement level, and the rooms are on the second floor. This constellation determined the sectional outline of the building. But the demand for plans were quite ambiguous. Each demand was so clear to some extent, but I couldn't see any hierarchy in those demands. And so there was no logical way to organizing the plan. I encountered the situation, function to be linked or space to be linked, not dominant in this design. In this case, I didn't try to evolve from linking spaces. Instead, I tried to leave such ambiguous, undissolved, such ambiguity undissolved. So I used a method of modeling method often used in a computer called metaball. In metaball, I think you know very well about metaball, each demand is defined by a ball, and the forces at work between balls are determined by parameters. Those forces are attraction and repulsion, and balls merge or interfere with one another under the effect of such forces. In this way, the beta balls makes it possible to create a form without an overall image, but simply through contiguous relationship of individual elements. Anyway, the building took a very soft configuration. For example, here, two balls meet, and this is the merge of the balls. Everything is melting together, like this. Inside, you can see snow in snow storage through heat-proofed windows, and where you can see the block of snow through windows on the floor. The rooms are on the second floor, and to give smooth access to there, the circular slope was introduced. The rooms merged into the one room space, but the space isn't homogeneous. There are corners and alcoves. The rooms has various characters, like this. And as snow foundation isn't a literal realization of the idea circulation body, but here too, I tried to find ways of design without precedence of space to be linked. Well, this is the house project. And all architecture can evolve from roads, I think, but the degree by degree, I was feeling at the same time, if roads are simply interpreted in linear spaces, the spaces are too strong, and the space themselves are deciding what will be happen in the building, and everything is predetermined. And it is contradiction, because I wanted to cut off space to be linked in order to make a place where people can find something interesting in the process of doing something. So I tried to go over the idea of a literal circulation body. And the name is all, consists of three levels. the first layers in this level is matched to the height of the existing concrete block fence. And so this layer is slightly submerged in the ground. The surrounding condition for each layer are very completely different. For example, the first layer is surrounded by the fence, concrete fence. One cannot expect any help from the surrounding scenery. So I prepared pocket gardens like this. And the second layer meets with the windows of the surrounding houses. And so I wanted to block the site. And I enclose it in a wall on the second floor. And up to the third layer, the view suddenly opened up. And so I open it right up to the surrounds, wide open. And based on this frame, I injected it with a sense that being there at that point in time is not an absolute. I thought the sense would feel on the ideal linking space is same, relativity to our current whereabout. You are definitely here, but the different here also exist. Just over there, you happen to be in this here, but you could just as well in the other, for example, in the dogs here. And this is the meaning of the relativity. And I made the movie from the dog's point of view.
Mr. Sandman, bring me a dream. Make him the cutest that I've ever seen. Give him two lips like roses and clover. Then tell him that his lonesome nights are over. Sandman, please turn on your magic beam, Mr. Sandman, bring me a dream.
this video clip cannot published because of the most difficult the character to be get the copyright. And so sometimes I show you in very private. And this is a Louis Vuitton project. In a space with a feeling of relativity, I call it is as a phenomenal circulation body. Louis Vuitton store in Nagoya, which was my first work for Louis Vuitton, was a project to transform a certain volume of air into a Louis Vuitton-esque qualities. Here, I used a double layer of patterns on glasses and create a moire effect, the existence of which was perceivable, while the sense of depth gives it a vaguely insubstantial appearance. The air of the street corner had to gain a particular quality of air distinct from the air of the city. And this is the next project for Louis Vuitton, the Louis Vuitton Ginza Matsuya, which was which I designed almost the same as the Nagoya, but I prize more fine, delicate expression in here. And, this building is the Louis Vuitton Omotesando, which was constructed in Omotesando district in Tokyo last year. And as you can see, it is a building made up of box-shaped units piled one on top of the other. And this is the beautiful group of apartments called the Dojukai apartments, and constructed over 70 years ago across the Zelkova Rhine street from where the Louis Vuitton building stands. And it not only has historic value as one of the first examples of Western style housing in Japan, but functions as an important symbol of the Omotesando district. This group of the building is characterized physically by the repeated use of small scale elements, the smallest architectural units such as windows and eaves and are repeated. And I tried it to give the Louis Vuitton Omotesando building physical characteristic similar to those of Dojunkai apartments. With the commercial building, there are always desire to make the building look larger than it actually is. And the most effective way of doing that is to make the building a single homogeneous object. But if I had done that, the result would be destroyed, the very quality that had attracted stroll to the district in the first place. And I applied the design method used in Dojunkai apartment, that is creating large hall through the repetition of small scale elements. A pile of trunks, it is not just the facade. The internal organization of the building as a whole is based on the idea of randomly piled boxes. And if you pile up trunks randomly, you would get in between spaces. And these interstices are used as terraces for balconies like this. And these interstices are covered by polished stainless steel panels. And so you get a reflection of trees, and you will feel in the midst of the forest. The store itself is like this, and you can see in the bottom part of the box above the top here. And this is the top part of the below box. the sizes of the box are determined by general demands of Louis Vuitton. These sizes themselves are spacious, but the boxes are too small to be subdivided. And so at the very least, each one must be used in full as a spatial unit. And the design was to control these sizes and the three-dimensional unit like this. And from inside, you can feel a mass of green through patterned glass and the metal fabric. And if you open trunk, there's no distinction between up and down. And so the inside of the entirely covered by one inner linings. In the same way, this is nothing differentiating the floors, walls, and ceilings. They are covered in a packet made from three varieties of wood. And this is a LB hole, a white inner lining. And what fashion brands ask of architecture is a fantasy, I think. But this fantasy doesn't mean that of Disneyland. And Disneyland's fantasy is a virtual world, totally displaced from the real world. But the fantasy of fashion brand is itself the real world. And, but it appears as an unusual aspect of it. And also in this hall, you can see the real surroundings, but in an unusual aspect. The white lining is made of custom-made fabric of white ribbon, embroidered on white lace. Oh, this is Louis Vuitton, New York. The Louis Vuitton decided to have a store at the crossing of 5th Avenue and 57th Street, New York. And this is the original building. It's a New York Trust Company by Cross & Cross, completed in 1930. Then our project is a renovation project. And the 1930s, it was the era of a few felices and the presentation of his skyscraper images. Their forms were generated from the 1960 New York City Building Zoning Resolution. And these images were drawings of skyscrapers shaped like a steep ziggurat or like bundles of crystals. And if you observe a natural crystal, then you comprehend its comprise a mixture of transparent parts and cloudy parts. The boundary between them is the gradation that naturally progress from cloudiness to transparency. I could innovate not only the lower part of the building, but also the corner tower. Because the building was previously one of Versa's building. Entertainment store, and they demolished the corner tower, and unfortunately for the building, but fortunately for me, and my intention was to refine the building into the single entity, architecture as a bundle of crystals. And so the exterior wall of the renovation is an entirely glass surface. But this glass is laminated strengthened glass with a fine white checkerboard pattern of ceramic flake on the inner surfaces. And there's also the fine checkerboard pattern on the interior face of the laminated glass, which results in a pattern film with a gradation from opacity to transparency. And by these layers, a natural transition appears within a field of transparent rectangles. Oh, this is the most recent realized work for Louis Vuitton. This is a Roppongi Hills store. And in the facade is made of a kind of a glass honeycomb structure wall. And maybe I think almost 30,000 glass tubes facade. This is like a champagne glass. And inside they will carve out almost everywhere by this kind of skin. The diameter of this arc is the same as the exterior glass tubes. It is 10 centimeters. Obsession. And a loin. A sense of that being there at a point in time is not an absolute. And I think this sense can be divided into two senses. One sense, you are absolute here. And the other, a sense different here also exists. And the place where you feel absolutely being here is a space where some rigid discipline or some generative rule results in. For example, the ruins, you can tell the reason why this is shaped like this. You cannot tell, you cannot tell the reason why this is shaped like this. But there must be some strict generative rule, and the rule result in it. Then we feel only the existence of the rule in front of the ruins. Then we don't feel the function or meaning. Oh, this is not my work. This is a store of Marta Margiela in Tokyo, designed by Marta Margiela himself. He created it by adding to and altering an existing house. The only step taken by Margiela is paint things white. Even the floor is white here. And this design seems to be an effort to erase meaning from a space that was originally shaped as a house, and to produce a condition in which people see it only as a thing. In this sense, this is the artificial ruin. In this space, I feel I am absolute here, and from this experience, I hinted one design method that I divided the whole design process into two phases. First, to create a ruin with some strict geometrical rules and without function and meaning. And then to renovate this ruin to a building required. And this is a house named B, has a simple form and an L shape. Boolean penetrates up another boolean in the shape of the upside down L shape. In this case, this form itself is a ruin for me. And then I utilize this given space to renovate a house. And this is a view of the exterior from the street. The side facing the street is a simple exterior wall of corrugated glass installated horizontally. This shows the part of interpenetration. The end of the one boolean appears on the corrugated glass facade. From the garden, two boreums interpenetrate. The back is different in expression from the front. Transition is abrupt here. Entrance hall from the garden, the house is situated at the corner of the crossing. And the entrance hall is open to both sides. And here the parking is facing to the one street. And at the end of this corridor is facing another street. And so this is a very complicated entrance. Basement. And there's a privileged space there isn't privileged space from which you can see and understand the overall organization. For example, the Jesus' neck, the phrase meshing together of two volumes resulting in the constriction of space, that serves the function of a door. Each volume is extremely non-uniform in character, but one door. When you walk along inside, scenes change at great speed. Spiral staircase. Second floor, you cannot even tell where you are in this building, whether it is the basement or second floor. Looking at from a broad eye view, the situation might be described as one in which various autonomous elements collide without mediation. The ruins was renovated into facets of a scene here. The house of the L, the next house. I have designed 8 houses up to now. And in addition, I'm currently designing 2 houses. And so there are also 4 residential projects that were never built. And so that makes 14 houses in all. And in publishing them, I made it a practice to refer to each one by letter of the alphabet. And each house is a unique individual solution. And the things that makes it unique are private matters having to do with a client. And there's no need for others to know them. And there's no, so the letters of the alphabet used to be, used to distinguish the houses without revealing the reason for their individuality. And I'm sometimes asked what I will do after I have designed 26 houses. I suppose I will quit designing houses. In any case, I call this house L. And like the house of B, this house has an overall form. The site is a triangular. A large tree stands at one end of the corners. And the root of the tree probably extended as much underground. So the part of the site available for the building, the house becomes available for the house is about this area. And so I put the concrete volume on it and to represent this available area. From the street, which is one floor below the level of the site, and the house looks like a blunt concrete box, simply sitting on the top of a stone wall. And this was determined from the site condition, but I wanted to give the form an autonomous character. I therefore gouged out force from and added projection. And the concrete box was a sort of emphasizing the bluntness. The end result resembled an angular fish. Yeah, you can see the overall form in L, which is not the case with B. In B, the overall form is an abstraction. But here you might say it is tangible. The part of the house facing the street, which actually is the first basement floor, looks like a stone wall has been cut away. The bathroom is situated behind this faint light. And when you enter the house and climb the stairs, the sudden just an instant. Oh, sorry. they hear that you, your field of vision suddenly expands. The sudden expansion of your field of vision during your climb up the stairs is a result of the fact that the discord doesn't reach all the way down to the floor. The plan of the ceiling seemed to sag in the middle and down to the level just short of the floor. Inside the core are small private spaces that you might call them bed box or bed turned into three-dimensional spaces. And I designed it L as if I had found a space already shaped for some purpose and were remodeling it into the dwelling. As in L, the overall form of the building of this house of I was determined, the form of the building was determined first in this I house. And the interior space were designed, but according to the entirely different logic, thereby defining the overall form. In this case, legal restriction, such as setback law regulations, determine the volume, the consideration of privacy, direction in which views were available, and the direction of a morning light determined the arrangement of the window. External heat insulation was installed in this building. The styrofoam was attached to the outside of the concrete and also in the roof. In this building, the roof and the wall has no distinction. Installation also meant that concrete could be different as the interior finish. But I felt that concrete by itself would be too assertive inside the building. Sealer normally used under the smooth coating of paint was applied to the concrete. And the transparent coating instead of paint was applied over it, while white patches appeared on the wall, but were not intentional. They were simply the result of slight irregularities on the concrete surface. There's some space suspended from the floor above. On this floor, the ceiling height is only 160 centimeters. On the top floor, the ceiling is only 60 centimeters at its lowest point because of the way of the roof slopes. The bookshelves. Also, the top floor. On the other hand, there's a narrow slit at both ends of the building, extending from the first basement floor all the way to the third floor. There's an extremely large discrepancy in scale. What I did here was to introduce things of different scale. On the top floor, the triangular window here is unusually large for the side of this room. It's difficult to tell if the room is large or small. I do not hold to the simple belief that things that are in human scale are comfortable. I believe instead that the feeling of comfort is born from the way different scales are combined. And I began this lecture with the idea of a circulation body, and I took my interest has moved from a literal circulation body. That is space evolved from linking space to the phenomenal circulation body. That is space in which you are definitely here, but different here also exist. And by designing several architectures in this interest, I found the possibility of the idea of renovation in a metaphorical meaning. At last, I would like to show you some ideas about the museum. My interest on museum is basically why so many good museums aren't designed as museum from the start. So many good museums are renovated from buildings for other purposes. For example, this brick warehouse was once used last year as an exhibition space for the Japanese artist Yoshitomo Nara. And it was a traveling exhibition. And I been to several of these tours, and I found the exhibition and this warehouse was best. The other exhibitions were held in a museum, designed as a museum. Tate Modern. It is also this museum renovated from the other building types. Its dynamic character, as power plant, is well preserved. Palais de Tokyo in Paris. It was formerly the, I think, exposition hall. And I think we should go upstream along the raison d'etre of the museum. What is the museum? And I think an art museum is a facility which is devoted to the human activity to make physical something happen. I was once invited to a museum as an artist, not as an architect. It was a golden opportunity to consider about that. My idea was to make something with a temporary exhibit walls. And I decided to make an in-between space inside of these walls. So it means this is the space for one artist, and also this is space for one artist, and this is also. And my space is still in this temporary wall. And actually, I use this area for my installation. This movie is not funny, sorry. So you can see the in-between space. And this area is brighter than the gallery area. In this work, I was very curious because the temporary walls are just temporary. But usually, there is an effort to give them feeling of permanent walls, pre-existing walls. But why? And so, I exposed these aren't pre-existed, and another kind of creation at the exhibition. And if we say the temporary, if we say the art museum is a fiction, the temporary world is also a fiction. But we know it is very difficult to draw a distinct line between reality and fiction. And my approach was to uncover it is just a fiction, but at the same time to give the fiction a kind of reality. In doing this, I felt if the space existed more independently, I could do something more straightforward. The gallery designed as a
gallery anticipates activities of artists. I think the gallery is designed as a gallery anticipate activities of artists is not interfere with the meddling before artists. And so galleries renovated from the space from other purposes cannot anticipate activities of artists. And if it is very comfortable for artists, and artists can be creative to do something happen there. And this is also like a ruins. The ruins also cannot anticipate activities, and it is very comfortable for people, and people can be creative to live there. Last project. Through these experiences, I have designed an art museum in the northern end of Honshu Island of Tokyo, Japan, Aomori Museum of Fine Art. Aomori Museum of Fine Art is next to an excavation site that reveals the skills and civilization of the Jomon period. Jomon culture was long regarded as inferior to that of Yayoi, but this excavation overturned that theory, so it is very important archaeological site. Anyway, the neighborhood neighboring sport park was converted into park for art, and the museum to be constructed is intended to serve as its core facility. Without the archaeological site, there would have been no plan to construct a building here. So I considered the museum's relationship to the excavation site is very important. This archaeological site is a landscape of soil, but in contrast to the natural landscape, it has a geometrically shaped trench carved into the earth. Even though the materials of nature is exposed to view, the scene is extremely artificial. So I propose that the landscape of a trench is dug like this, and in the ground be first created. And I defined this that trench space as a museum of fine art, and this furrowed surface upward is combined with the furrowed surface structure facing downward. This is the image of trenched created. and the two furrowed surface produced interstitial space. And it was competition, and in my competition scheme, I proposed that interstitial space having earthen floors and walls be used as galleries too. Museum is made of only two independent elements, an earthen surface and a white surface that cover it. And because they are independent, the result is sometimes an extremely low intensity. At the times, be an extremely narrow, tall, crevasse-like interstice. Looked at from bird-eyed view, the shape is not so complicated. But if you take an elevator down to the galleries, you will discover varieties of nameless spaces. Anyway, this rule of two furrowed surfaces generate automatically two different spaces. The one is the inside of the structure. It is, can be used as a white cube galleries, and the other is the in-between space, and it is will be the site-specific galleries. But and from outside, but you cannot imagine this this happens inside. This is, for example, the extremely low interstices and very tall interstices. And in this museum, in the character isn't provided with sampled personal image, but the more logical procedure. So I hope it will be gained the characters which anticipate of artist. Entrance lobby for galleries and gallery. I think this is the end of the slides. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Wonderful. I'm sure that there will be some questions, so maybe we could have the lights on, and if there's anyone who wants to leave quickly, they could do so. I just want to ask you about sort of the obvious thing, which is really the relationship between the video pieces, animations, and the kind of wit that's involved in those, which seems to be, I mean, now, in fact, you know, one sees so many of the standard architectural animations, which are primarily a kind of technological device of see-through. And how did you come about using this? How does it relate to the work? At what stage do you use this material and so on? So maybe you can speak a little bit about the relationship between this kind of investigation and the work.
The architecture is very interesting because, for example, the house you design, you designed, and the client can look at this work every day, but you cannot, even you an architect, you cannot be not every day. And so I think the architecture is the after comprehension of architecture, it is the outside of us. And so the idea about architecture, it remains, but how you can present this idea. Also, you can use a photograph of the images, but it's also the fiction. And if you select several photographs, it is because you like this photograph, but also it can represent which you feel in this architecture. And so for me, this is a video clip is also the same. But if this is just for the explanation, it's not the same in my brain. And so I have to find out some idea of how to create the video clip.
So when do you use this, you produce this before the work, after the work, a way of explaining the work, or? Where does it come into the process?
It depends case, but for example, for the Aomori, that this is the not, this is now under construction, and so, we ourselves will want to check the every space combination or sequence of the spaces, and so this is the primary device. But for the video of the dog's view is the after compression, and it is because this video itself was shooted 2 days before the clients started leaving, and so we have only 2 days to make some the video clips for that, and so after that I edited. So to refine some movie like this.
Does anybody want to? Can you take the mic so that people can?
I was interested in your very first image of the island and your description of the. Intensity of the street and the living, and that somehow that's the key to the way in which you develop and look at the way in which your architecture works in that way. But I wonder what your feeling is. I mean, I know you showed the bridge, but that is kind of almost like a moment in a larger situation where you have the street, where you have the urban plan. Whether going outwards rather
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's a very difficult question. But for example, if we design a more larger scale, for example, and we have two choices. One is develop the every space by the linking space like a street, and the other idea is to eliminate every linking space instead. And because if we keep the idea of zoning, and we keep the very traditional thinking about urbanism, and it doesn't work very well in my experience. And so I think that I have no chance to design urban design, but still, for me, if I design some cities with more larger area, I will introduce how to cut off this just street, or the just space to be linked. And so it must be, I will try to define the new solution. I have no idea about that now.
I mean, when do you think you started having this interest specifically in the question of interstitial space? Mm. Where did this interest come from?
I like the pattern of camouflage pattern, mm-hmm. because for example, we can say something with the idea of the figure and the background. But still, in this case, the figure is the dominant, and the background is minor. But in camouflage pattern, it's at the same level, and so it can be the dominant, both part. And so when you design something, you have two objects, and the interstice is usually an indominant space, a minor space. But I think I want to make this interstice space as strong as the objects. So. Mm-hmm. And this is, I think, is my feeling about mm-hmm. the object. And so I wanted to find some idea about to enforce the interstice.
Mm-hmm. In most Japanese architecture, mm-hmm. it's mm-hmm. the object mm-hmm. that's yeah. often the dominant.
Yeah.
Is there something part of the tradition of Japanese architecture where mm. this question of the interstitial, or as you say, the tension or balances between different figures is, as you say, changed so that it's not an object? Mm. Does that exist?
Mm. I don't think it's not so related to the Japanese tradition, but still, when I explain about the Aomori Museum fine art, I showed you the summer. One image about the trench, and this space itself is carted, excavated, made. But the purpose of this excavation is not to make this space, but to find something, but to dig out the stone or something. And this is the purpose of the excavation. But as a result, the interstice itself is very strong. And so in a field of architecture, I don't think we have any heritage about this idea. But in the nature, well, through some factory design or some other field, we can find a very interesting situation about space.
In fact, in terms of yeah. traditional city, you mm-hmm. have a lot of that
mm-hmm.
in development. When you look at the medieval city or something. There's someone at the back, maybe you can pass the line.
I just wanted to ask you about an aspect of the difference between the two animations that you have. In the first one, the point where I think it's a severe flip, but there were lots of potential or real floor levels, as well as
For me, this space has two levels, only two levels. But still, fundamentally, if you cut the excavate the earth like this, and it's going up and going down, and it is possible to have three levels, for example. But still, I think in the middle levels, very, very similar feeling with the bottom. And so I think the major distinction is will be happened in the bottom of the this fallow space and also top of the earth. And so this is a very, very straight. And so, and also from top, this is the feeling of that biting together. And so this is like a teeth. And so you have a very, very simple feeling about the height and the width of the space. And so this is a major intention for me to introduce this idea of biting together. It sounds good for me.
No, I think that the title that that John has with the circulating body, in a way, it's also important. Maybe I think one of the things that is very strong when one visits your building is that you're really using the question of movement. Mm. In the video, of course, the concept of circulation in terms of movement through the building is the thing that's emphasized. But actually, in terms of the experience of the building, what's important is when you're looking at them from the outside, the buildings are really set up to be based on the notion of movement and the experience of the body. So the experience becomes very extremely visceral, as opposed to just seeing an image of the building, because of the fact that in many of these buildings you have double layers of glass, for example, with pattern and so on. The skin is constantly kind of pulsating, undulating, changing, and you don't get the sensation of, in a sense, a fixed image. And that's really something I believe quite significant in terms of the kind of research that you have made, which we didn't see in a way with the presentation today, where there is a lot of investigation to explore the way in which these materials, the different kinds of glass and so on, produce these sorts of experiential conditions, which is not just really based on a kind of imagistic idea, but really exploring things in the factory and testing them and seeing them on site. Mm. And so I think it's also had a significant effect in terms of the way in which you have developed processes and procedures of design where you're exploring, in a sense, fragments of the building at full scale before you design a facade. And I think those kinds of organizational structures are also, I think, very much related to this idea of circulation, which I think makes the work quite exciting and interesting. Yeah. You can go back and...
No, I have already some images for the process of these things. No, if we have some time,
we can
have
5 minutes.
5 minutes or something. Yeah. As he said, today I don't talk about my design process, but for example, I will show you the very quick presentation about one process of the building, because we make lots of prototype and we make up models to find a good material and the way of to use the material. This one, I think. And so we'll start by very, very quick. No explanation.
This is the process of the one building design. And the, and this is the we. This is not so. We, this is just check the positioning of the windows. And this is this. And car of the windows. And another idea. For example, this scale. Yeah, this is a research about the building nearby. And to check the material. And this idea is to use glass, laminated glass, but the side. And this is the one option. This day. And this is the decent idea. And to check the effect of the material, the windmaker of the models, for example, like this. And take the, this is lamination of the perforated metals, and how we can make the camouflage pattern by using two metal sheet, and the, we made a lot of studies about that. This is the, just sift some centimeters to make a pattern, and it makes, this is, it's laminated, it makes the subtle feeling. Changes. And I believe there's some moving images inside of this. I don't know where is the moving. But this is just, for example, the size of the hole is changed. And this is the model of this. This is two slight effect. And so we developed other idea of that. And I think this is the other idea to how to laminate two layers. And this is the, this is first the movie, and so we checked by the videotape, you know, to test the changing effect of the facade. This is the real size prototype.
Sorry, but still, for example, our goal is not so difficult. For example, in this case, we want to make produce the camouflage pattern. and but the, it's not so direct expression. It can be changeable from the angle you are, and so the very very this is the delicate study about the facade. This is just introduced, and so from the front and from the little side, it's a little different, and here is also different. But anyway.
Well, I think it's great to see you working with fashion and seeing sometimes actually the kind of directness of the fashion business in a way becoming so much part and parcel of the way in which you are also working out buildings and the way that you deal with their materials and testing them and exploring them. So that, I mean that's fantastic. The next two lectures, the evening lectures, will be given by two historians. So next week we have H. Allen Brooks, who is a fantastic world authority figure on the work of Thorpe and Wright, and he'll be giving an evening lecture next week on the work of Frank Lloyd Wright. Following that, I think three or four evening seminars at 5 o'clock during the week. And the following week, Lisa Dardeen, who has just written a very interesting book on Robert Hooke, who was an architect who became a very significant scientist, and he actually was very much fascinated with the whole system of circulation and worked with foil and with the discussions of the body. She will be here and we'll talk about REM. So that would be very, very good. That Tuesday, in 2 weeks' time, we also have a conference or a tribute to Cedric Price, who unfortunately died a few months ago, and people like Rem Koolhaas and others will be here to pay tribute to Cedric, and at the end of that week we have Friar Otto. So I think it's a busy few weeks, but I want to finish by thanking Jun Aoki and all of you. Thank you.